goodness with care from our villages Arokya milk.
Welcome to episode 10 of Mahabharata with Anuja. We are at the halfway mark, people. Thank you so much for sticking with me. Now, in the last episode, I told you about the grand sabha constructed for Yudhishthira by Maya. The Pandavas were at the zenith of their prosperity, and it was at this juncture that they had a visit by sage Narada. Narada came up to Yudhishthira and he said, Narada had the ability to travel the three worlds at will. So he said, I was in heaven recently and your father Pandu wanted me to tell you that it was his heart's desire that you perform the Rajasuya Yaga. When Yudhishthira heard this, he thought it was quite an honor, but he felt it was a big responsibility as well. So he decided to seek Krishna's advice. And Krishna came at once. He said, you guys do have what it takes to perform the Rajasuya Yaga, but before you do that, there are certain obstacles that need to be taken care of, and the chief amongst them is Jarasandha. And he told them little more details about the mighty emperor of Magadha. He said, Jarasandha has an empire. He thinks he's the supreme emperor. He has captured 86 kings and he needs just 14 more, and he's planning to perform their human sacrifice to Shiva. So he's like a really powerful and a monarch who abuses his power. And then Krishna also said that Jarasandha hated Krishna. There was a reason for this. Jarasandha had twin daughters named Asti and Prapti. Now they had been married to Kamsa. Kamsa was Krishna's maternal uncle, and they were sworn enemies, and as a child Krishna had killed Kamsa. So his two daughters had been widowed, and Jarasandha had immediately attacked Mathura in retaliation. Now 17 times he would have gathered huge armies and he would have attacked Mathura, and 17 times Krishna destroyed the armies, but he spared Jarasandha because it wasn't his destiny to kill Jarasandha. And the 18th time there was a twin threat because there was another warrior named Kalayavana who had challenged them. So worrying for the safety of his people, Krishna did something miraculous. He raised the fabled city of Dwaraka from the sea, okay? And they say it was an impregnable and beautiful fortress. And this also they say that the streets were paved with silver, the pillars were of solid gold, all the citizens ate from plates of gold and silver. There were precious gems to spare, I would say. So, it was because Lakshmi was the consort of Vishnu, and she blessed Krishna's enterprise and she took residence there. And Krishna magically transported his people from Mathura to Dwaraka, and they were safe there because none could enter Dwaraka without Krishna's permission. So Jarasandha had to return disappointed, and that took care of the threat. But Krishna said he still has an issue because he knows you all are my friends, so he will not allow it. So without neutralizing this threat, you cannot proceed. And Yudhishthira immediately asked him, how do you recommend that we go about it? He said, just send Bhima and Arjuna with me, trust me, I'll take care of everything. And so it was that the three of them made their way to Magadha, the mighty empire of Jarasandha. Now on their way there, Krishna told them a little bit more details about Jarasandha's somewhat unique birth, I should say. Now, Jarasandha's father had spent many years performing penances, and yet he hadn't yet had a heir. So he approached sage Kaushika, and this king asked him to bless him with a son. And the sage gave him a mango which had fallen on his lap. He said, give it to your wife, you will have a very strong son. Now this king, he had wives who were twin sisters, and he would have made a promise to their father that he would always treat them without any partiality. So he took this mango, cut it in half, and he gave it to both his wives, and in due course they conceived. Everybody was very, very happy, but their happiness soured during the delivery. Both the wives, they delivered lumps of flesh which had one eye and one ear, one arm. It was like that, and they thought it was some sort of monster, and they tossed the two lumps of flesh away. Now, as fate would have it, a flesh-eating Rakshasi named Jara came that side, and she saw these two lumps of flesh, and she thought, okay, that's my dinner, and she grabbed it, and she put it close together just so that she could carry it, and magnetically those two just fused, and suddenly she was holding a bouncing baby boy, and he had a very lusty cry, because you know his cries woke up the entire palace, and they all came charging out, and they realized that this was their baby. And the king asked her to spare the baby's life, and Jara very graciously she said, okay, I will not eat him, I will gift him back to you. So the child was named Jarasandha, and you know, he'd become the mighty emperor of Magadha. Now Krishna, Arjuna and Bhima were dressed as Sanatakas. Now these are people who would have taken a certain oath, and they lead a certain kind of lifestyle which involves prayer and stuff like that. Now in this disguise they approached Magadha, and instead of entering through the main gate, they chose a different approach. One of Magadha's natural fortifications was a mountain peak named Chaityaka, sort of like our Himalayas to the north. It was like this massive peak, and the three of them tore it down, this massive peak. They just tore it down, and all that remained was rubble, and then they stepped over it and they entered Magadha. Of course, this was considered extremely inauspicious, and all the people ran to Jarasandha and they said, you know, something horrible has happened. Chaityaka has been destroyed and three strangers have come in now. And Jarasandha immediately called his priest. He was a superstitious man. They started, you know, performing sacrifices to win the favor of the gods. And when these Brahmins, these Sanataka Brahmins showed up, very respectfully Jarasandha addressed them, and he offered them some of the sanctified offerings. They said, sorry, we will not consume anything with salt in it. This was very weird. So Jarasandha just said, I'll ask for you to be escorted to, you know, my luxurious guest chambers. Make yourself at home. I will see you shortly. Jarasandha went to visit these strangers, and he knew that there was something very bizarre about their behavior. Okay? He noticed that all was not as it seemed. They had bowstring marks, though they were pretending to be peaceable men of prayer. And there were other factors, the fact that they wouldn't eat anything made with salt. So he asked them outright, that was his style. He said, tell me who you are and what is your business here. It was Krishna who answered. He said, you have 86 kings here. You plan to sacrifice them. Release them or we will be forced to fight you. And Jarasandha said, why should I release them? I defeated them in battle. I can do what I want with them. And Krishna said, that's why we are your enemies. We wouldn't eat your salt and we didn't come through the front entrance. Jarasandha immediately said, tell me who you are if you want to continue this discussion. And Krishna revealed their identities. And Jarasandha was very angry. He said, I knew only a cowardly cowherd like you, you'll do despicable things like this. I don't even want to talk to you. If you all want to fight me, that's fine. I'm ready. What do you want? Shall I send for my army? Will you bring yours? And Krishna immediately said, let's have a mano-imano type event. And Jarasandha said, of course, I'm not going to fight with someone lowly and despicable like Krishna. And he said, Arjuna is just a boy. There are some fools out there who say he's a great warrior, but I don't think so. Bhima at least is my equal physically, so I'll get some satisfaction from killing him. And so with these, brave words, they prepared for a fight. A pavilion was erected, and Jarasandha very generously, he gave weapons for Bhima to use. And the bout between the two of them commenced. It was a long and bloody clash between these two behemoths, and blood flowed freely as the two of them started wounding each other. And the fight was dragging on and on, and Jarasandha was tiring. And Krishna noticed this, and he told Arjuna, it's going to end soon. And Bhima immediately turned to Krishna, hoping for some cue. And Krishna immediately picked up a blade of grass. He tore it in half and he threw both ends in the opposite side. Okay? And Bhima immediately tossed Jarasandha to the floor, and grabbing him by the legs, he tore him apart. I'm sorry, graphic violence here, and he tossed the two ends of his body on either side. Okay, and that was the end of the mighty emperor of Magadha. Now the mighty emperor of Magadha was dead, and his three killers, they acted very quickly. They installed his son Sahadeva on the throne, and he swore loyalty to Yudhishthira, and he paid a very hefty tribute. I don't think he had much choice. So these three heroes, they were extremely successful. They returned to Indraprastha, having overcome this first obstacle. And then the four brothers of Yudhishthira, they set out in the four directions. Now Arjuna went to the north, Sahadeva to the south, Bhima to the east, and Nakula to the west. And it was a period of imperial expansion, and they conquered everything in sight basically, and the kingdom became massive and lots of money poured in. And once all this was done, preparations were made for the Rajasuya Yaga. It was an extremely lavish and grand affair. There was so much pomp, splendor and opulence on display. And all the kings of that particular age, they all showed up out of respect to Yudhishthira. So everybody who was anybody was there basically. And the Rajasuya Yaga was done very, very well. It was towards the end of the Yaga that there was a major incident. Now at the conclusion, the first worship will be offered to the most eminent person in the gathering. And Yudhishthira approached Bhishma. He said, "You are the grandsire. Please tell me who deserves this honor." And Bhishma did not even hesitate. He said, "That honor has to go to Krishna. We are all blessed to be living in the age of Krishna. He's the most amazing, wonderful soul out there." And Sahadeva immediately clapped his hands. He said, "The grandsire is always right." And he took the first worship and he offered it to Krishna. Now there was one person in that assembly who was outraged by this. His name was Shishupala, and he also had a history with Krishna. Now he would have been promised the hand of Princess Rukmini of Vidarbha, but her brother Rukma would have been a friend of his, and he would have convinced their father to get Rukmini married to Shishupala. Now Rukmini hated Shishupala, and she'd lost her heart to Krishna. So she would have written to Krishna and begged him to come and rescue her. So Krishna would have carried her away, and Shishupala had never ever forgiven him for that, and he hated him with every fiber of his being. So he stood up there and he said, "I think all of you have gone completely mad honoring one lowly cowherd like this. It's just disgraceful." He turned to Yudhishthira. He said, "I didn't come here because I'm scared of you, okay? It's just a mark of respect. Don't think you can abuse my position because of that." And then he said, "You're young. You and your brothers are still young. Bhishma is the old fool who should have given you all better advice." And he started saying really horrible things about Bhishma. He said, "I think he's gone senile, and he's probably practicing celibacy because he's impotent." And he said extremely yucky things like this. And Bhishma didn't even bother to reply. It was Sahadeva who answered. He said, "The grandsire is right. If anyone here insults either Krishna or my grandsire, I will step on him with my feet," he said. And now this time, not only Shishupala, a lot of the gathered kings were offended, and they all stood up like that, and Shishupala immediately gathered them to his side. He said, "What, you all think you can say whatever you want? I am the bull of Chedi. I will destroy all of you." And he started speaking all sorts of stuff and hurling insults in all directions, and he decided to walk out from there. Yudhishthira, ever the pacifist, he went behind him. He said, "Please reconsider your position, come back." And then Bhishma said, "Yudhishthira, let him go. He's not worth wasting time on." And he told everybody gathered the story of Shishupala's birth, which was very unflattering. Apparently, he'd been born with a third eye, and he had extra arms and legs. So his parents, again, they thought he was a monster, and they wanted to kill him. But a divine voice was heard. The voice said he's destined to meet his end at the hands of the noblest soul to walk on this planet. And so his mother immediately should have asked, "Tell me who's the slayer of my son." And that voice said, when this child is placed in the arms of his slayer, his third eye and his extra limbs will disappear. And so lots of people visited the Chedi and to see this child, and Shishupala's mother would have placed him on all their laps. And Krishna would, he'll be a relative of this lady. you know, on the paternal side. So he would have come to visit his aunt, and when she places the baby on his lap, as prophesized, the third eye and the extra limbs disappeared. So picking up her baby, she looked at Krishna very sweetly, very beseechingly. She said, "Krishna, promise me, no matter what my son does, you must not get angry with him, forgive him." And Krishna told her, "Don't worry, aunt, I will forgive him 1,000 times. And Bhishma said, "This fellow nicely, he took advantage. He's done all sorts of horrible things to the Yadavas." And then Krishna stood up. He said, "I kept my promise to his mother. I've forgiven him 1,000s of times. He snuck into Dwaraka using his status as a relative. He set fire to all our homes. He's abducted our women. He's stolen cattle from us. All this I've forgiven. But today he's gone too far. His time is up." And the chakra materialized on his finger. It whizzed through the air. And the next thing, the bull of Chedi, Shishupala, had been decapitated. And there was blood spilled there. So it was in a yaga, when this happens, it's considered extremely inauspicious. So, you know, there were a lot of horrible things awaiting the Pandavas. And I will stop right there and conclude this episode. I hope you enjoyed it. Do tell me what you thought about it in the comments section. Don't forget to hit like, share, and subscribe to our channel, and join me next time. Until then, take care.
With care from our villages, Arokya Milk.